In this video, we'll discuss about Cardwell loop operation. We'll discuss this topic under definition, indications, contraindications, what is the surgical procedure, post op care, and complications. It is the method of gaining entry into the maxillary sinus via canine fossa approach. That means by preparing a window at the canine fossa. So when you are writing definitions, two words are important here: maxillary sinus and canine fossa. If you write those two words and underline them, it is enough to show the examiner that you know the concept, right? Then coming to the indications. In indications, this procedure is indicated in cases of intrasinus foreign bodies, that is any root fragments or tooth escaped into the maxillary sinus, especially when you are extracting the maxillary second premolar and palatal root of the maxillary molar. There are the chances of escaping the root fragment or remaining apical third of the root fragment escaping into the maxillary sinus. So in those cases you are going to do the Cardwell loop operation. And intrasinus cyst and tumors involving the maxillary sinus, in those cases also you may use Cardwell loop operation for definitive treatment of cyst and tumors, that is complete excision of the cyst and tumors, or you may use it for biopsy purposes also. Then chronic maxillary sinusitis, in this case due to the chronic nature of the maxillary sinusitis, you have to do the completely clearing the infection in the maxillary sinus. So in those cases it is helpful for drainage and irrigation of the chronically infected maxillary sinus lining. And oroantral fistula, the same thing. In oroantral fistula also there is infection of the maxillary sinus lining. For that you have to go use Cardwell loop operation. Then mycotic fungal balls, that is fungal infection involving the maxillary sinus. And epistaxis controls also, you may pack the maxillary sinus so that bleeding is controlled. And orbital floor fracture, as we discussed earlier in the orbital fractures, antral packing can be done with the help of Cardwell loop operation. So these are the 7 indications of Cardwell loop operation. Then coming to the contraindications, this is generally not done in young children, that is due to the fear of injury to the developing tooth buds, that is permanent tooth buds. And it is generally not done in the cases of acute infections, generally done in the cases of chronic infection, not done in the acute infection. So those are 2 contraindications. Then coming to the surgical procedure, for surgical procedure you can see in this diagram, the first step is to, the procedure can be done under general anesthesia or local anesthesia also. The first step is to make a semilunar incision in the maxillary vestibule, buccal vestibule. Okay, you can see this is the maxillary arch and this is the labial and buccal vestibule. So a semilunar incision is taken. Semilunar means it is curved like this. This curvature, that is convexity facing towards the alveolar process. So this is the incision site. This incision site extension is, you can take from maxillary canine to the up to the first molar or second molar, depending on the situation. Okay, you can take it from anteriorly extending from the maxillary canine to the maxillary second molar. So this is the soft tissue incision, semilunar incision. Okay, once you incise the soft tissue, and next step comes is subperiosteal dissection. You will completely elevate the mucosa subperiosteally. So after elevating mucoperiosteal flap, so this is the incision site. Okay, this is the incision site. After elevation of mucoperiosteal flap, this is the area of the anterolateral wall of maxillary sinus exposed. You know that the wall facing towards us is the anterolateral wall of maxillary sinus. in anterolateral wall of maxillary sinus, there comes is the canine fossa. So once you expose and once you do subperiosteal dissection, after that the next step is to identification of canine fossa. You have to identify canine fossa. Canine fossa is nothing but a depression in the anterolateral wall of maxillary sinus. It is usually located above the root apex of the canine and somewhat posteriorly. You can see in this diagram. Okay, you can see in this diagram, for the identification of canine fossa, you have to draw a vertical line from the pupil of the eye like this. Okay, one vertical line drop downwards from the pupil. Okay, then a horizontal line at the level of the ala. Okay, nasal alar basis, a horizontal line. So the junction of between these two lines is the canine fossa. This is very much important, the identification of canine fossa. A vertical line from the pupil and a horizontal line at the level of nasal ala. The interjunction point is the interconnecting between these two lines is the canine fossa. The reason behind doing a window preparation in the canine fossa is that the wall, the anterolateral wall of maxillary sinus is thinnest in the canine fossa region. Thinnest. So that you can easily make a entry into the maxillary sinus. So after identification of canine fossa, you are going to prepare a window, that is bony window preparation. So this is the exposed bony area. First we will do, you will follow posterior stamp method, that is preparing small holes in the bone, preparing small holes in the bone, and after that you are going to connect them like this. This is posterior stamp method of bone removal. First we have to make the holes in the bone, then you are going to collect all those holes, and the bone in between this area is removed. So after removing the bone, you are going to enter into the maxillary sinus. This opening should be sufficient enough to pass a index finger so that you can feel any abnormality or any system tumors in the maxillary sinus. Okay, after window preparation, you are going to address the abnormality. That means for what purpose you are making the window preparation? You are doing caudal look operation. If it is for the purpose of foreign body removal, that is root escaped into the maxillary sinus, you can irrigate the maxillary sinus so that the root is flushed out. Root piece is flushed out. Okay, alternatively, you can use vacuum pressure, that is suction placed at this window point, so that by the pressure the root is sucked out. Okay, if it is for the cystic tumors, then you can remove the completely inflamed maxillary sinus lining, or if there is any sinus cyst is involved, then we can remove that. That is addressing main abnormality. You can do anything for in the chronic maxillary sinusitis cases. You are going to completely irrigate the maxillary sinus lining with the normal saline, or you can use the betadine also. And if the maxillary sinus lining, epithelial lining, is infected and it is inflamed, then you can completely remove that lining from the bone with the help of Howarth elevator or periosteal elevator. You can separate the this maxillary sinus lining from the bone and you can remove that. For the OFA cases also the same thing, and you can remove any fungal balls also. And epistaxis control, for that you have to place the antral packing, and for orbital floor fracture also it is same. So addressing the main indication. After that we are going to irrigate the socket, irrigate the maxillary sinus, complete bony window and complete bony maxillary sinus, and after that you are going to close it. That is, you are going to place the sutures. There is no need to fix this plate again. That is, fix this bone on that bony window. You can remove, you can left that bony window as it is. You will just provide the soft tissue closure. Okay, so this is the step by step procedure of the Caldwell look operation. Then coming to the post operative care, post operatively you should advise that patient should not blow the nose or should not sneeze for at least 4 to 5 days, and post operatively you are going to prescribe antibiotics, analgesics and decongestants also. Okay, and for allowing drainage, in some cases you may combine this Caldwell look operation with intranasal antrostomy also, that is preparation of the making a small bony window in the inferior meatus, so that by the gravity any collection of the fluids or drainage will come out. You can make that also intranasal antrostomy. Then coming to the complications, the main complication here is infraorbital nerve paresthesia. If you follow this method, you can maximum avoid the complications, because you can see this is the canine fossa region, this is the canine fossa region, and this is the ASA nerve, that is anterior superior alveolar nerve, supplying canine lateral incisor and central incisor, and this is the infraorbital nerve. Okay, this is the infraorbital nerve, this is the ASA nerve, this is the canine fossa. You can see that by preparing a window in this area avoids almost injury to the infraorbital nerves. Okay, so complications includes infraorbital nerve paresthesia or any bleeding. Okay, and then paresthesia of the upper anteriors because of the injury to the anterior superior alveolar nerve block, nerve ASA. Okay, and after that drainage, maxillary sinus drainage may be blocked postoperatively. These are the some of the complications of the Caldwell look operation. If you like this video, hit the like button, share the video, subscribe the channel.